Welcome to the Niche Pursuits Podcast. Today we're joined by Jason Mills, and we're talking all about age domains, specifically an age domain case study that Jason launched exactly 6 months ago to the day. Fast forward to right now, in the last month of earnings, we're over $3,500, and he's doing this with only 41 articles live. So we dive into the entire process that Jason has gone through to grow this site to where it is today. Niche selection and age domain selection. I'll tell you that a lot of his success started by picking a very, very monetizable niche and one that he had some experience with before. We talk through the metrics he used to evaluate what makes a good age domain and what he is looking for in one. We talk about the first month and a lot of the indexation issues he had and what he did and didn't do about it to get it off the ground. Get into some of his keyword research, or at least how he vets what types of articles to write. We talk about, obviously, his monetization strategies. They're very good. And as you can tell, this isn't a site that is monetized by Amazon. He's using a private affiliate network and a private affiliate program. So we kind of get into some of the ups and downs that come with basically going with private affiliate networks, how it's pretty easy to find ones that don't do well and what to look for in an affiliate program that does do well. This site obviously is really doing well. I mean, even for an age domain, that's a really quick startup. And even with some of the recent Google updates that they've launched, it's continued to do really well. Jason has a YouTube channel that he documents a lot of his other websites on, and he has put together a playlist specifically for this aged domain case study. He has reopened it up where he actually does give us access to the domain name itself. You can plop it into an SEO tracker, see all the keywords. You can go peruse the website itself and look around. He's made it available for a couple of months. So if you're listening to this podcast in the first few months that it's been released, hey, see it through and you'll get great access to see this age domain in real life. And so head on over to his YouTube channel to find more about that. In the meantime, though, enjoy this great interview with Jason about his success with an age domain website. Did you know that texting is the most convenient way to reach your customers? We talk a lot about email marketing here on the podcast, but I often hear many of you say, hey, I don't really even open a majority of the emails I get. You also hear of social media marketing as being a great way to reach your customers, but we know that really only a small fraction of your audience will ever even see your posts. But what about text messages all at once? You can have two-way conversations with them, and you can trigger automated text messages for things like appointment reminders, text for info programs, sending files back and forth, pretty much anything that you can think of. Plans with simple texting start at $29 a month, but you can get a special promo by being a Niche Pursuits listener. Text niche to 823-2-TRY-SMS, and you'll get an additional 500 credits added to your simple texting account. Let me read that to you again. Text niche to 833-287-9767, and you'll get an additional 500 credits with simple texting. Welcome back to the Niche Pursuits Podcast. My name is Jared Bauman, and today I am joined by Jason Mills. Jason, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, Jared. Pleasure to be here.
It's great to have you. I'm super excited for what we're going to dive into. But before we do, so I just added some of this like blue backlighting, uplighting, and you're like my second or third recording since I added it, and I've already met my match. I think yours definitely outdoes mine. I love the backlighting on the bookshelf. I think I'm gonna have to add it to my shelf or bookshelf back there.
Yeah, I like it. It looks good. Yeah, very similar color scheme going on there. Yeah, it looks good.
It's a very blue, it's gonna be a blue themed podcast for those of you who are watching today on YouTube. I mean, I don't want to bury the lead, but I'm super excited for today because we're focusing our conversation on one website and one website that you've created from an age domain, and specifically one website that is going very fast in terms of its growth and success. Before we get into it, give us some background on you and your journey into affiliate marketing and website creating.
Okay, sure. Affiliates, I've been working on probably for around 3, maybe 4 years. It's something that I've been aware of probably since the age of about 20. Clearly, I'm not 20 anymore. But it's not something that I really got into properly until about 3 or 4 years ago. I first started kind of getting into SEO. That was the kind of my initial foray into the online world. And that was purely off the back of, I started a fantasy football blog, and it was just giving out tips for fantasy football. So fantasy soccer, if you're in the US, and essentially, yeah, I was putting tips out each week. It was getting some traction. And as that started to happen, I wanted to learn more about how to generate more traffic. And that was what first got me into learning about SEO. And so I was, and at that time, I was a teacher. So I was a secondary school teacher, teaching drama and media studies. And I was kind of at a point where I had to either commit career-wise, or I had this opportunity to explore this online world that was still fairly new to me. So the fantasy football blog, I kind of learned a little bit of SEO, got a bit of traction with that, got a membership going to on it. So it was generating a few hundred dollars a month, nothing major. I did a podcast to go alongside it. We got a sponsor for the podcast, which brought in a couple of $1,000 a year. And that was, like I said, that was where I kind of honed my skills, as it were. And then from there, I started to dabble in a little bit of client work. So predominantly, well, it started off a bit of graphic design, a bit of website design. And then I started to realize that the money was in search engine optimization with, you know, higher ticket clients, retainer. So I kind of got to the point where I couldn't do both. I couldn't continue the teaching and service these clients to the best of my ability. So at that point, I sold the fantasy football blog. Mm-hmm. And not a huge sum. I think it was about $14,000-$15,000, but it was a nice little sum to kind of put away and allowed me to kind of make the jump from employment into essentially self-employment. So I had a little bit of a buffer in terms of cash. We just moved house and we'd taken on a bigger mortgage. And to be fair, the wife was fantastic. And she said, you know what, if you don't do it now, you never will. So I did it. And like I say, started off predominantly with client work, and then kind of 2 or 3 years into that, realized that, okay, I'm getting pretty good at this SEO thing now. Why am I just working for other people? Why don't I start my own projects?
Yep.
So that's kind of where the affiliate story started, really.
You know, they say not to go full time, but at the same time that you make a crazy, like whether they call it a financial move or a life-changing thing. So you were basically moving house, upgrading the mortgage, and also deciding to go full-time at this. Was it a quick turn-up? Like when you went from selling the football website to doing client work, was that a quick turn-up? And the reason I ask is I bet there's a lot of people thinking, maybe they're a secondary school teacher as well, and they're kind of thinking about that transition and trying to understand, maybe if affiliate marketing is my end goal, does doing client work in the meantime make sense?
Yeah, I think so. I think I would say the transitional period was probably around 2 years in total. So from when I started the blog to when I, maybe even longer than that, maybe 2.5 years. But the way I looked at it was a period of time where I could learn new skills. And I even took on writing gigs on I don't think it was Upwork, but there were some online platforms that I became aware of where you could sell your wares, so to speak. And I got a few writing gigs. And again, it's obviously working for other people, but it's on your terms. You know, freelance, you can do it at the time that's convenient to you. So, I mean, it was crazy at the time. It was mad. I mean, I remember we were recording podcasts actually in my office at school. I mean, you'd finish the day of teaching, and then there was a couple of guys in the PE department, the sports department, and they'd come down, and we'd all kind of huddle around. In fact, it was this microphone. It was microphone that we used. So I would take the microphone with a laptop into work, And then we'd sit in the office and get around the mic and record a podcast, which was mad. But it was all of those things that I did have contributed to what I now do with the affiliate websites, you know, from the graphic design, you know, designing a podcast cover, you know, you look at it with a featured image, just the, you know, learning WordPress, which yeah. obviously is quite a task in itself. And I made tons of mistakes, but it allowed me to cut my teeth. Mm-hmm. But the time period was probably about two and a half years, I would say. The last 6 months of that, I was starting to take on client work. So there was about a 6 month period where I did it. But yeah, I mean, I wouldn't advise, you know, leaving a full-time job and increasing your mortgage and, you know, kind of jumping into the unknown. But I think I always kind of had this backup plan that if I needed to, I could do some supply teaching. So it didn't feel like such a huge jump, but looking back, it was a bit silly.
No, it's good. I mean, you know, everyone responds differently too, right? I mean, some people need to kind of jump off the cliff and build their wings on the way down, as a mentor of mine used to say. Other people do better when they can plan and forecast. But I think you're right. Like, you know, hearing that it was a 2.5 year journey, you can tell a story in an elevator pitch in 30 seconds, but the reality is that there's 2.5 years behind it of hard work that went on to the point where now, you know, you are now where you're at with basically your full-time job being website building. All right. So where are you at right now with your portfolio? And obviously we'll talk about this one site today, but I know it's not your only site, and maybe fill us in on those details, fast forwarding to right now.
Yeah, sure. So I still have this client serving business, and until around 12 months ago, I classed that as my main business. And I've just got a handful of clients doing that now. So that's, but what's happened now is I've got this second business, which essentially is which covers my entire portfolio of affiliate sites that are mine, and that has superseded the income that comes from the client work. So now I class that as my main business. In that side of things, I've got 7 or 8 affiliate projects that I'm working on. So they're all separate websites. Like I said, they all kind of fall under the umbrella of one limited company, just for the kind of just for accounting purposes and things like that. But they're all mine, and that is where probably 75% of my time on a day-to-day basis goes now, into those affiliate sites. And in terms of income, I set a goal at the start of this calendar year to hit $20,000 per month. And I just hit that in the last month. So I didn't think I was going to get there. And part of the reason why I've been able to get there is because of this website that we're going to talk about today, and the fact that it's flown in the first 6 months.
Yeah. Yeah. Let me ask you one more question before we dive into this website. Because this is a common problem. Like, how did you balance having client work, having servicing clients while also growing your own websites? And I ask from a time standpoint, how did you make sure that you were delivering for your clients month in, month out, but yet still carving out enough time to grow your own site? Sure. Not getting too sucked into the client work, but also not putting all your efforts into your websites and not serving your clients.
I think the thing is, you have certain clients that take up a lot of time. And I had a lot of smaller clients that I would be servicing. So they'd be on retainers of maybe $300 a month. And they were taking up a huge amount of time. And so what I've done over time is, as some clients have faded away, I've just not replaced them. So very much in the early days, I still with my client work, I still make sure that I deliver. But yeah, it's the focus now is on those who I consider to be the key clients, the clients that I want to work with. So I'm very picky and choosy on who I work with. And I will occasionally still take on a new client, but I've tried to, as much as possible, unless it's a referral from an existing client, I pretty much don't take on client work now, because from a time point of view, it's just not worth it. But then at the same time, the affiliate space can be very lonely if you're working solo. So I do like to, you know, still have that 20-25% time allocation to client work where I can check in that, you know, they'll give me a call and, you know, even reporting and stuff like that. And you know, those are the guys that if they weren't there 3 years ago, I wouldn't be doing this now. Mm-hmm. So I still kind of feel like I have that moral obligation to work with them. And you know, on those projects that are longer term, it's not as time consuming to work on them because they're kind of running a bit more like clockwork now mm-hmm. because of the processes and everything else that's gone before. So yeah. So it's not a massive issue.
Yeah. It's a good balance. It's a good balance. Good for people to hear how to frame up kind of balancing multiple things. Well, let's dive into this, why don't you bring us up to speed on this website? It's I caught wind of it on your YouTube channel, which by the way, I love your YouTube channel. I'll make sure we get that in the show notes. I'll tell you a quick story about it. My family and I, we bought a travel trailer this summer, early summer. And, it was about 6 hours away, the one we had identified. And I had to just take it for the team and drive up and back. My wife had our kids for the weekend and I drove up and back in one day and picked it up. And I binge listened to probably almost every one of your videos or darn near close to it.
Oh, no.
So I spent a day with you on a Saturday driving up and down. But it's great. It's a great, great YouTube channel. And you have gone through an age domain case study on this channel. That's where I was really intrigued to learn about. Why don't you bring us, set the story and set the stage for this age domain that you started working with. And we'll dive into the whole nuts and bolts of it throughout the rest of this interview.
Sure. So it came about because of the YouTube channel, I suppose. I interviewed a guy who owns a marketplace for age domains, a company called SERP Names. And we did the interview. I was just trying to pick his brains really on age domains because I'd never done an age domain project before. So we did the interview. It went really well. And then about 2 weeks after that, he reached out to me. He said, what if I give you a domain of your choosing, will you run it as a case study? And he didn't necessarily want me to disclose the URL or anything like that on the case study. And I said, look, yeah, more than happy to do it. It was something I'd wanted to do anyway. And actually, rewinding slightly, I had just bought an age domain, which I'd found myself using Spamzilla, and it was a GoDaddy auction, and I picked it up myself for $3,000. So I just started. So the timing wasn't perfect because I wouldn't have chosen to start two age domain projects at the same time, particularly not knowing exactly how it was going to work. So, but I thought, do you know what? You can't look a gift horse in the mouth. It's free. So let's go on and try it and do it. So so I went on their marketplace, had a look, and I'd looked at this domain about 6 months prior. So I know for a fact that this domain had been sitting on that marketplace for a good 6 months or so. And that was a slight concern because I thought, well, it's just been sitting there with the old content. Nothing's going to have happened with it. Is it going to be a bit stagnant? I don't know. But anyway, I went for it and the whole process was very smooth. If I had bought it, it would have cost me $3,000. So essentially the same as what I'd paid. It had some really good backlinks. It was in the niche. Well, it was closely related to the niche that I wanted to take it into. It wasn't exactly bang on, but it was close enough. And yeah, so took ownership of it and started publishing content and that was the beginning of it really.
Let's share with everyone where the site is at now so they can kind of get their mind around it, how long it's been, and then we'll kind of unpack the details. I already have some questions for you about, you know, niche selection and how you evaluated this domain specifically. But you know, catch us up to where it's at right now and then we'll go from there.
Sure. So it's amazed me, it really has, because I've never had a site that's performed this quickly before. So it's since I took ownership, it's been 6 months.
Okay, 6 months.
Pretty much to the day, pretty much 6 months. And its last full month, it did just over $3,500 in commissions. So it's purely affiliate commissions. Now, it's not with, you know, crazy amounts of traffic. I just pulled the data today. I don't think I sent you this actually, Jared. So it's done 5,628 organic hits in the month of the last month. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then, like I say, $3,500. So it's mad. It's mad. I can't think of another word to describe it. I just I couldn't have done that with a fresh domain, particularly in this day and age. And even in the first month or so, it still had its issues with indexing and things like that. Initially, stuff started to get indexed. Then suddenly stuff wasn't getting indexed, and this was all documented. And I was thinking, oh, okay, well, at least this is going to make me look genuine on the YouTube channel, because I'm just going to go warts and all.
It's good to have some failures. You know, you look like a real human.
Exactly. Exactly. If it tanks, it tanks, and so be it. But then that lasted about a month. And then all of a sudden, there was just one day where everything just suddenly, something, it was like something clicked. Everything indexed, and I say everything, there's still not a huge amount of content on there. There's 41 pages on the site at the moment, so it's not a massive website at the moment at all. So about 63% of it, I did the maths, is like commercial type content. The rest of it is either info content or like your standard navigational pages, like your home, about us, contact us, privacy policy, stuff like that. But yeah, now stuff's getting indexed. Like I say, I couldn't be happier in terms of the revenues that it's making. It'll be interesting to see how that goes over the next, you know, 4, 5, 6 months.
So the overarching question I can't get around, and I'll probably ask this in 3 or 4 different ways throughout the interview, but like, maybe do you have a sense of what has made this site so successful? I mean, you have another age domain site that you're working on. I'm guessing it's not quite as wildly successful as this. Most sites would never be this successful. Like, do you have a sense for what has made this so successful out of the gate?
Well, the other age domain is not as successful as this one, but that's at around the $500, $600 a month mark. So it's still making money.
Which is still very reasonable for a 6-month-old site.
Yeah. And that one's probably a couple of months old. So that one's about 8 months.
Okay.
So, you know, like I say, I'm not saying that what's happened with this site is necessarily the standard, but in terms of what I've done, I suppose I've put more focus into this one because I've ran it as a case study. I put it out there, and obviously there's that accountability factor. So because of that, yes. And I think the other thing is I've stayed extremely tight with the niche. So I've not tried to make it too broad. It's in like the health and wellness niche. Mm-hmm. But it's in one very focused area of that niche. So it is, I suppose, it's a YMYL site. But I think part of the reason for the success is because of the you know, I've stayed as close to that niche as I possibly can. Whereas the other age domain site, it's also in health and wellness, but I've gone broader with it. Mm-hmm.
So the hyper relevance, that could very well be. Let's talk about how you picked this niche. I mean, picking a niche to focus on is often a big stumbling block for people. It's, you know, a lot of things to evaluate, a lot of things to look at. When you bring an age of domain into it, there's another added layer of it. And now you're also trying to, you know, vet the age domain that you're looking at, the website. How did you go about picking not only the niche to go into, but then vetting the age domain that you selected?
Okay, so the niche, I was already familiar to an extent with it. I've got other sites that are UK-based websites that are in the same niche, or actually they are broader sites, but and they focus on this niche as part of the site. Okay. Mm-hmm. But because this one was targeting the US and worldwide, I suppose, I knew I could go tighter in with the niche because there's more search volume. It's a bigger country. So I suppose I liked the niche, but on top of that, and I suppose more importantly than that, it was that the commissions for the products that you sell are very high. They're 50, 60% commission.
I was going to say, clearly this is not an Amazon, just looking at the numbers. You're not selling shills on Amazon here.
Absolutely not. There are some links that go to Amazon, but purely because that's the only place that sells the product. And typically they're not the products that I am recommending because they're not as good. And also, like, obviously, the commissions are much, much lower. So Amazon, it makes pennies each month, but that's not the aim. Yeah, the aim is these other bespoke programs that they're really good programs. And the products are good. You know, they're, in fact, because I've got a couple of writers that work on the site, and one of the writers uses the product, or one of the main products that we promote, he uses it himself because he believes so deeply in the product. So good. It's and that really helps, because he's super passionate about this product, and when he comes across products that are not as good, or, you know, they've not got, you know, the ingredients in them are not as good, or he feels they're not as good, or they're not as well backed scientifically, he just calls them out, and he's super passionate about the product that we want to promote, and it just so happens that we do get 50% commission on that. So it's a good situation to have.
So interesting. With the domain itself, was there a certain number of, say, backlinks you wanted? Was there any other checks you went through, or being that it was just such a good niche match for what you wanted to do, maybe you didn't pay as much attention to that because you had found a niche domain that had some history that was very niche relevant?
Yeah, the key for me with the backlinks, I'm not too concerned about the number of backlinks. It's authority and relevance and traffic with those backlinks. And they're my three main metrics for any kind of backlink building, you know, that I do. It's relevance to me is the number one. And then as long as the site's got some decent traffic, and you know, if it's high authority, even better. And this site had a mix, so it had some super high authority backlinks. It had the relevance, and they all had traffic. You know, of course, there were backlinks there that were irrelevant, yeah, but not that many actually. And it was, I think the site used to be it was a tech startup, but for an app that was very closely linked to the niche. So okay, it had perfect backlinks. I couldn't have asked more. And then the other thing is that I always look for is branded backlinks. You know, so the name of the brand going to the homepage. If you've got those, then you've already kind of got that brand built for you. And so that's half the challenge. And then, I mean, I've not built many backlinks to this site at all. I think I've built 7 backlinks to it so far. But you can be a bit more aggressive on the anchor text with those, because you've got all that branded anchor text, yeah, going in. So it's a perfect situation. But it did have a few links going into specific pages, so old inner pages on the website, but not many. So that was helpful, because I didn't have to do a lot of redirects, or I didn't have to resurrect a lot of old pages and then pass the link juice that way. It was fairly low maintenance to get it set up. I think there were 2 or 3 pages, and 2 of those I resurrected the content and then built internal links to where I wanted them to go, and then the other one was a redirect. But then on top of that, obviously doing the due diligence on the age domain, so just making sure that it hasn't been used for anything else, so that it hasn't been used as a PBN or, you know, as a link farm, as a guest posting site or anything like that, or it hasn't been used as an affiliate site and been penalized. So, and everything checked out. So for that, I just used Wayback Machine. That all checked out. So there were no concerns. And the pages that were live were all still indexed. And some of the pages that weren't live were still indexed. So that was another good sign, because okay, Google's happy to keep those indexed. So that they were all kind of ticks in the box, really.
I was going to say, as I bump my mic here, you know, you kind of went through, and it sounds like a perfect scenario. And not that age domain or building on an age domain can't work if, you know, one of those metrics is a little off or something. Like, it's always just a bit of a relative thing you're trying to come up with there, but it really sounds like the perfect scenario. Did you keep the brand, if you will? Like, this used to be an app, and now it's your website, and it's kind of just a review website. Like, did that transition well, or did you tweak the brand at all?
No, so I did tweak the brand a little bit. So the website was kind of initials, if you like, and then that I think that was the name of their app, and I just changed what those initials stood for. Mm-hmm. So yeah, and that was as far as it went, really. I did pay homage to the old app and the startup company. So I think within one of the pages or the About Us page, it mentions that this used to be a different brand or a different site. But yeah, that's as far as it went, really. Obviously, the name of the URL worked. It wasn't perfect, but you know what? Even if I was starting an affiliate site from scratch, I would go with a brand anyway. I wouldn't be looking for partial match domains or anything like that. So to have a brand name, and then it kind of forces your hand, and you just have to be creative. It didn't take me that long. It probably took me 10 or 15 minutes just to think, right, what can this letter be? And what can this letter be? And it worked. It worked.
That's great. Okay. Well, let's talk about the initial build out, and you kind of teased a bit, like it had some indexing issues. How did you go about the initial phases of the site? I'm going to guess keyword research and these kinds of things, but it's particularly from an age domain standpoint, you know, what was your plan of attack and what were your top priorities to get going with this site?
Sure. So I already knew that there were certain products and certain keywords that I was going to want to target because I was familiar with it. Mm-hmm. But because I've not worked on this niche in the US, there were other products that I'd not come across. So I started to quickly come across products that were not great products, but there was good search volume for them. So these might be ones that were promoted on Amazon, or they might be on like late night infomercial ads. And I don't know if they still do those, but if they do, then they might be on those. So sometimes, you know, that throws up additional opportunities. So I quickly realized that there's a real opportunity here to target these keywords and then suggest an alternative product. Because these products were not brilliant. They wouldn't have made commercial sense to necessarily promote because they might not have an affiliate program, or they're on Amazon. So what's the point? But to be able to review it genuinely and then give a better alternative that then makes more money for the site, it just made sense to do that. And some of these, I mean, there's one review product that has almost 15,000 searches per month. And it's a review keyword. It's not even the brand. I mean, the brand gets about 90,000 searches a month, but the review, you add review onto the end of the brand and it's like 15,000. So there's massive traffic opportunities there. And I didn't necessarily know that they existed at the beginning. So it started off, and I always start the same. I always start with just the basics, obviously the homepage, about us page, contact, all the nuts and bolts that you have to do. I don't necessarily build a bank of content out at the beginning. There's nothing wrong with doing that. I tend to just, you know, publish as I've got the content. And I tend to write the, you know, all those nuts and bolts kind of pages. I'll do that myself. And then I always try and write a couple of pieces of content myself, you know, the commercial stuff. But I was lucky because I already had this writer who is brilliant in this niche. So I tasked him, and I just said to him, I said, I've got a new site. I really want to kind of hit the ground running, because he's obviously already working on these other projects that I've got.
Right.
And I'm suddenly going, oh, can you do an additional 50,000 words a month? But he was excellent. And as long as he knew in advance, I mean, he was doing his master's at the same time. So he was, you know, we knew that the 3 months into the project, he was going to have to take a month out because he had to get this done. And he'd got a book being published and all this sort of stuff. So so it just meant I mean, again, like I said, it's not massive. There's 41 pages, but it just meant we really tried to hit that commercial content as much as possible in those first 2 or 3 months. And again, like I say, it wasn't huge. It was probably 10 to 12 pieces of content per month. And like I said, the first month or so didn't index, but then suddenly it started to, and now stuff indexes pretty much the same day. And that was it. But in terms of the process of getting stuff set up, yeah, all the basics, like getting the right plugins in, and I just use Rank Math for that. I tend to switch between Rank Math and Yoast. And I don't think it makes any difference, but and then like affiliate link cloakers, plugins, and stuff like that. Yeah,
we had actually somebody else from the UK, Ted French, on a while back, maybe a year or two ago. He had talked about we had focused on a site of his that he had built from an aged domain, and he went through a different process where he restored some of the original pages as they were, waited for those to get indexed, and then changed them a bit. I might be getting some of the details wrong, but that's why I wanted to hear from you, maybe some of the details about how you did it. And
Sure.
There's a number of ways to do it,
so
right?
So I did that with a couple of pages, restored the content. Because when I took ownership of the site, one of the things that this company did was they essentially rebuild the site. But it's not set up on WordPress. I think they just use the Wayback Archive and push it up. So it's there, but you can't really go in and work with that. Mm. So I was quite conscious of the fact that we were suddenly going to go from a site that had 50, 60 pages to a site that had 5 or 6. So that was a concern. And that just kind of forced me to just work as fast as possible. Like I say, there were 2 or 3 pages that were resurrected, and then, and again, paid attribution to the original authors and all of that. Whether they will be happy with that, I don't know. I don't know if I've infringed on any copyright. Hopefully not. But it's nowhere else. It's nowhere else on the web. The company, I think, folded, and that was why the domain became available. And then there were 2 or 3 pages, like I said, that needed to be redirected. And that was it. It wasn't a huge, arduous task at all.
Yeah. Okay. So what did you do, if anything, about the indexing issues? I know, man, that's an issue that all of us over the past year or two have had an issue with in some way, shape, or form, whether with a new site, an old site, in your case, an aged domain site. Like, did you do anything special to get around that or just keep pushing through it?
No, and I purposely didn't, because I know that there are things that you can do. I mean, what you mentioned the YouTube channel, and one of my best performing videos is actually talking about how to overcome indexing issues. But I purposely didn't want to implement any strategy like that. I just wanted to let this happen naturally. So I thought, and like I said, I was fully prepared to just go warts and all and say, look, this isn't getting indexed. It's 6 months. The age domain makes no difference, all the rest of it. So I just thought, let's see what happens. And it was about a month. And actually, one of the videos in the case study that I've done, it's me sitting there saying, we've published this content, it's not indexing. And then about 2 weeks after that video, it suddenly happened. So I created another video that said, we have liftoff, and it just started from there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's talk about these articles that you're creating, because I'm kind of looking back over my notes here. The site is generating, I think, it's so niche dependent, so I don't want to categorize it, but I know a lot of people will hear, I think I wrote 5,600 page views in a month and $3,500 or plus dollars a month. And people will hear that and think, wow, that's a lot of money per page view. And then they would hear like 41 pages and think, well, that's not a lot of page views for the number of pages for the amount of money that you make. So clearly there's something to what is going on each of these pages that's allowing it to be so highly monetized with relatively few page views. Do I have that accurate? And if I do, like, maybe talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's accurate. it's difficult to kind of quantify, really. What I would say is, on any page that I have, I always just try and have a single intended action for that particular page. So if it's a review page, obviously the main focus of that page is to get the person to click and to buy. If it's a buyer's guide, of course there's going to be multiple links to different products. But one of the things that I've started to do, and actually started pretty much from the beginning, is to kind of almost give like a quick verdict up towards the top. So if it's a buyer's guide, it's very clear to the reader which product, we're recommending. This is the product. There might be a short featured image, short intro, quick verdict. It's like a pop-out box, call-out box type thing. And then obviously that will have a call to action in it. And then it goes into the rest of the content. So, you know, we'll have product one, product two, product three. And with each one, just the basics, you know, images linked, decent call to action, and then another verdict down at the bottom of the page. And that's it. I don't think there's anything. I think obviously the content matters a huge amount. I think, you know, and that was what I very quickly learned, even more so with this site, is that my writers can write better than me. Particularly this one. Like I can write, but I don't have the kind of scientific or the medical knowledge that this writer has. You know, he's a qualified personal trainer. Like I said, he's doing his master's or PhD in a related field at university. So he knows his stuff. So he can write it, and it just comes across in a way in which, you know, if I read his stuff, I want to buy the product. So when I'm going in and editing it, and that is one thing, I have edited all the content on this. So I proofread it, edit it. So there's obviously been a time element there as well. But yeah, his content is just good, you know, and that obviously is half the battle. It's half the battle. But yeah, that would be one thing that I would definitely suggest is, one clear call to action. I've never run ads. I've never run display ads on a website because I hate the distraction. I hate it when I'm on a site. And when I look at other people's affiliate sites and there's, you know, they've got their button for them, their call to action, which obviously that is going to make them more money if someone clicks that and buys than that display ad that's next to it. And then there's a display ad underneath it. And then there's one in the sidebar. And it's like, what do you want the user to do? And then there'll be a pop-up for an email, or there'll be an email subscribe opt-in somewhere else. It's too much. Make it very clear what you want the user to do. And that's that's the only thing I can attribute, you know, that high conversion rate. And of course, what makes the difference with this site is just that the high average order value and the high commission rate. And you also get commissions on repeat orders too, so that obviously helps.
Oh geez, man. Well, yeah,
it's such a good program.
It's my question. I mean, and this might date us back to your other website where you caught on to this product, this category and whatnot, but I mean, how do you find affiliate programs that convert so well, pay so well, and have such good terms? Is obviously we can all just Google in, you know, product affiliate programs and stuff, but it's very difficult to ascertain if they're going to do well. And a lot of us have, absolutely, me included, I've, oh man, I got to get on this different affiliate program. I got to get off Amazon. You throw up an affiliate product into some of your higher traffic pages that you think is a good affiliate program, and you end up sending 1,000 clicks there and one person converts. So, you know, there's always that trepidation, but there's the risk of just not getting anywhere with it. Like, how do you find these types of programs?
It really is trial and error. I don't think there's any other way. I've got, again, on this particular site, I've got one affiliate program, and it's a very well-known brand. It's endorsed by celebrities, you know, and I've not had a single sale. Not had a single sale of this product. Okay. And okay, it's not our top promoted product, but it's probably our third or fourth. So on most buyer's guides, it's number three or four in the list. We've got specific review pages for it that are fairly well positioned. It gets traffic, it gets clicks, but it doesn't convert. And it's at the point where I'm looking at it and going, is there an issue here? Is there a technical issue?
Right.
But the program is registering the clicks. So now I'm starting to think, is this a scam? Because it just doesn't make sense.
Okay.
But yeah. But you have to kind of go through that process, and but that makes it very, very difficult for someone that's not entered a niche before and hasn't tested these programs. I mean, the one thing I would say is, of all the sites that I've ever had that have promoted Amazon has always converted pretty well. So if you are going to go in with Amazon, you know you're going to get a decent conversion rate if everything else is in check. And then if you've got other places where you can promote products and test out other programs, that's a good place to be, because you've got that fail safe of Amazon, And then you've got that aspiration of trying a better program. But if it doesn't work, you can go back to Amazon. But yeah, it's really difficult. And I'm just so grateful with this one that the genuinely what I think is the best product does convert and it has those well. Good commission rates. And you know, there are others that convert pretty well, but they don't pay out as much. So there's one that's 30%. But they're a great affiliate company. They reached out to me personally. In fact, they saw the affiliate manager saw the YouTube channel, saw the case study, and reached out to me. In fact, he reached out to the company because he wasn't sure if I really was running the site. So the company that I bought the domain from, then Summit, the owner, he then emailed me and said, "Look, this guy is interested. Wants to, you know, sign you up as an affiliate. Can I pass on the details?" So like, yeah, it was, and so they came to me, but it's 30%, and there was not a huge amount of wiggle room there. But then when you do get these programs with these affiliate managers, you can definitely negotiate higher commissions. And as your traffic improves, there's definitely, I mean, again, not in this niche, but the same company, the same program, because they have various products that they promote, you can get as much as 65% commission, which is, you just think their profit margins must be huge to be able to offer that.
Wow. Yeah, I was going to say, is your commission rate at this point the standard one, or have you been able to leverage that up higher and get that to a point where it's a little bit better for you because you're using it across multiple websites, you've been with them for a while?
Yeah, it's just slightly above base. So, but then what will then happen is if you've got good traffic coming into your buyer's guides, you have these companies that then pitch against each other. So they'll go, "Oh, what are you getting? 60%, we'll give you 65. And it's like, okay, but then they're running a program as well where you get prizes, you get points and prizes. "Oh, we'll match that. We'll give you an iPhone every couple of months." And this world, I would never would have believed existed 8 years ago. Mm-hmm. Never. It's just insane.
I'm glad you touched on it from the standpoint of you don't know what you don't know. And I think that there's a tendency for people to knee-jerk reaction is to go onto Amazon for their affiliate program. Me too. It's just so easy. Yeah. And then we hear interviews like this, and there's going to be someone who hears this and sits down tonight and says, "You know what? I'm sick and tired of getting 4% on Amazon. I'm going to find some other affiliate programs." And they spend an evening, a week, a month of free nights. They put that on their site. They wait a month and then they don't get the results. And it's just encouraging to hear from you. Here's a really successful website that's converting like gangbusters with one affiliate program. But even on the same site, same product line is just ghost town with a different affiliate program. And it just gives that encouragement to people like, hey, sometimes you got to keep trying until you find the right one. And then when you find it, figure out how to exploit it as much as possible.
Absolutely. And I think a good sign with an affiliate program is if the affiliate manager is open to discussion, if they engage with you in emails or they want to get on a phone call or on a Zoom, then that's a really good sign. If you just get ghosted and you email them and there's no reply, that's usually, in my experience, that's a bad signal. And, you know, I've even had some affiliate companies that have audited my site for me or a page. They'll look at a page and go, "Oh, try this for conversion and try that." And that is really helpful because obviously they work with the top affiliates. And I'm nowhere near that level. But that's the other thing. Like some of these programs, they have leaderboards. So I think on the one that I'm doing really well with, I'm 22nd on the leaderboard. And I feel like I'm doing amazing because it's not just this site that I've got. I've got a few, I've got multiple sites. And the guys above me are so many points ahead of me. They're like about 50 times more than what I'm doing. So then that makes me think, okay, well, if I'm doing this, there are guys out there that are making 150K a month. And maybe it's a publishing company, but it's possible. Mm-hmm. You know, there's enough traffic out there to make 150, 200K a month. And that's what kind of drives you on, I think, to improve.
Oh, cool. What are your plans for this site? I mean, at 41 pages, I feel like you got some runway. You can you could keep going if you wanted to. You know, like what are the next 6 months to 1 year look like?
Yeah, I mean, I want to run it to the 1 year point at least, and see where we can get to. I always it's difficult because with a fresh domain, it, at least in my experience, the kind of sweet spot of where I think a site peaks is around 3.5 to 4 years. So, but I think obviously with an aged domain, I genuinely think you're probably saving yourself 2 years of work and costs as well with backlink building and all that sort of stuff. So I think potentially the sweet spot would probably be around the 18-month to 2 year mark to look to sell the site, because then you're going to have a good history of earnings. The site, obviously from a buyer's point of view, they want the site to be as stable as possible. From a seller's point of view, I don't want to sell someone a site that's in decline. I want, you know, or that's risky. So, you know, we've all seen these horror stories, haven't we, of people that have bought sites for millions and then they've you know, bombed. So I don't want that to be the case. But yeah, I think there's definitely scope. There's definitely scope. I think the one thing I would say with this site is it's pretty closed into the niche that it's in. There is room for a bit of expansion, but because I've gone so hyper targeted, it is limited to an extent. Mm-hmm. But there's still, yeah, I think this could be easily a 150 page site.
Okay,
which, you know, let's say we, even if we 3x the revenue from here and it gets it to 10k a month, I'd be pretty happy with that. Oh, at this time. Yeah.
I was gonna see which way you went with it, because you talked at the beginning about how it's a very hyper relevant site, and that's always a question, right? Like when you kind of get to the end of a silo or a topic cluster, depending on the site's focus, you kind of start wrestling with, do I go into another silo, another topic cluster? Do I just try to keep it here? So yeah, it's very interesting to hear which way you're gonna go with it. And you're probably still trying to figure some of that out to figure it out for the future. But yeah, that sounds like a very, very good plan. Wow. What a fun case study and a fun ride. And you're only 6 months in. I think it's great. I didn't give a shout out to your YouTube channel earlier. I'll mention it now. It's The Affiliate School on YouTube. You're on Twitter as well, right? Aren't you?
Recently started. Yeah.
It's a new thing. New. So, and what's your Twitter handle?
Do you know what? I had to look it up because I wasn't even sure what it was. It's at Niche Jason. Niche okay. Jason, which I might regret that name, but
it's okay.
I chose it.
So, and then, you know, talk about what have you been doing on the YouTube channel as it relates to this aged domain case study? Because you've got a lot of other videos on there about some of your other websites, but what can people find out about this one over there?
The process, really, I suppose. You know, there's some technical stuff, so some over the shoulder. This is me setting up a post. This is how I structure the articles. But yeah, pretty much it's the process of, you know, from A to Z, I suppose. I try not to leave anything out if unless I have to. So I've been fairly transparent with it. Although I know we had a discussion about sharing the site, and I've kind of gone in two minds. Initially, I've shared the site and I've kind of took some of those videos back down. But I think for people that want to see, I said to you, I'm more than happy to put those videos up for a couple of months. Let people check those videos out. I want to be transparent. I want people to see, throw it into Ahrefs or something, or SEMrush. Look at what it's ranking for. Look at the traffic. You know, it's all there. And again, everything shared in the case study videos. So the Google Analytics and even screenshots of the earnings. Just because I remember being that person sitting there and going, that can't be real. and you know, and like, I'm nowhere near the level of lots and lots of affiliates, but I feel the last 12 to 18 months has been a bit transformative, and it feels very much like an upward trajectory across all the sites. And that's the idea of the channel, really, is to kind of document that process and to share it. And I suppose it kind of goes back to my teacher roots, really, is that, and maybe that's why I called it The Affiliate School. You know, it's just trying to teach, trying to show, share, inspire, that's the idea.
You mentioned that you had a background in drama, and I can now see those effects with some of the production value and some of the fun things you do. So that makes sense. It's really nice of you to offer to kind of reopen that up, because you had pulled it down, and that's not a permanent thing, but it's really nice of you to open that back up for people to go and check out. So if you are listening to this in the first couple months, we'll get all that in the show notes for you. And you can kind of just go binge watch like I did. Although I didn't get to take part in the over the shoulder stuff because I was driving, but you know, the stuff that I could listen to, I did. And that's great. You know, it's really emblematic. It's such a cool little story, like that you can tie a bow on, because so many times we'll talk about a website, but we'll interview, you know, someone who's had this success, but they've kind of gone in and out of it, or life's come and other opportunities have come. And this one just has such a really tight timeline that I feel like there's so much to learn from the process. And it's really great talking about age domains, because yeah, you said it, like it probably shortened 18 to 24 months off of the journey on this one. It's just fascinating.
Absolutely.
Well, hey, Jason, thanks so much for joining us today. Really appreciate it. And we'll keep up with you over at your YouTube channel. But until we talk next time, all the best.
Thanks for having me, Jared.
Did you know that texting is the most convenient way to reach your customers? We talk a lot about email marketing here on the podcast, but I often hear many of you say, hey, I don't really even open a majority of the emails I get. You also hear of social media marketing as being a great way to reach your customers, but we know that really only a small fraction of your audience will ever even see your posts. But what about text messages all at once? You can have two-way conversations with them, and you can trigger automated text messages for things like appointment reminders, text for info programs, sending files back and forth, pretty much anything that you can think of. Plans with simple texting start at $29 a month, but you can get a special promo by being a Niche Pursuits listener. Text Niche to 823-2-TRY-SMS, and you'll get an additional 500 credits added to your simple texting account. Let me read that to you again. Text Niche to 833-287-9767, and you'll get an additional 500 credits with simple texting.